everyone, Pioneer and Apple here with the last two box sets in the Ninth Doctor Adventures, Hidden Depths and Shades of Fear. It has been a while since I listened to Hidden Depths, but was too busy to write a video for it. So let's go through these stories quickly and head on to the newer box set after. First, we will talk about Seas of Titan, written by Elizabeth Miles. Now, this is by no means a bad story, but I do recall having a few gripes with it. Both Sea Devil and Silurian stories commonly fall into the same trappings, and I feel that comes from the root of what these races are, commentary on ideas such as colonization and how different, yet similar people should be able to move past their problems and coexist. Usually leading to the non-humans wanting what was theirs back, and sometimes a base being under siege. And this is definitely one of those stories. As the human settlement that finds themselves against the Sea Devils are very isolated on Saturn's moon, Titan. The human characters weren't as two-dimensional as I thought they would be, and the ending didn't stand out to me as strong, but my favourite part of the story was probably the exploration of the Sea Devils' life under the moon's waters. Their structures and politics draw your attention and imagination quite well, and is not something I recall being present in the Sea Devil television episodes or previous audio stories quite prominently. Both bringing something new and replaying old tropes, this story was a mixed one, but I still enjoyed the listen, and I'll give Seas of Titan by Elizabeth Miles a 6 out of 10. Next is Lay Down Your Arms, written by Lisa McMullen. And it is a strange one, probably the most original out of these 6 stories, having no returning characters and, to my memory, is a pretty new concept in Doctor Who. While many of the side characters, such as Bertha's mother, don't really add much for me, the ideas of the spa's water making people quick to anger, and the way that Trinity, the villain, used this for their strange plan that may have been described with a little too much blatant, if necessary, exposition, were certainly interesting and kept me engaged. The Doctor was as good as always, but to be honest, this is probably the one I have the least to say about. While good, it still didn't seem to leave as much of an impression as the other two stories. I suppose that is the price the story pays for being more original and without the obvious draw-ins of the other two in the box set. I'll give Lay Down Your Arms by Lisa McMullen another 6 out of 10. Lastly in this first box set is Flat Pack by John Dorney, notable for the return of Liv and Tanya from Stranded, which I could not have been more excited about. The story of Flat Pack itself takes the idea of the seemingly never-ending shopping trip, such as has been explored and exaggerated in the SCP Never-Ending IKEA, as an evil store spreads across time, enveloping people inside itself, and the staff having suspiciously familiar voices coming from behind their creepy masks. Starting with the return of the companions, both played by returning actors Nicola Walker as Liv and Rebecca Root as Tanya, were great, and written quite in line with their usual characters. Definitely a highlight, especially when Liv becomes their only hope, using an ingenious solution to win the day. Nine is great, and his interactions with the two I loved. The story itself, while I thought it was inventive, I did predict a few of the twists, which could make it feel a little boring, but there were still nice surprises within that almost overshadowed that feeling. I'll give Flat Pack by John Dorney a 9.5 out of 10. This leaves the Ninth Doctor Adventures, Box Set 7, or Season 2, Part 3, Hidden Depths, a 7.1 out of 10. Now we go into the final box set of the Ninth Doctor Adventures so far, Shades of Fear, and the first one of these sets to use the new logo, a fact I'm sure that really pisses off hardcore aesthetic collectors. The box set contains 3 stories: The Colour of Terror, The Blooming Menace, and Red Darkness. Once again, the Ninth Doctor is played by Christopher Eccleston, but do these stories hold up in being the potential end of the Ninth Doctor's adventures? Let's find out, starting with The Colour of Terror. And there will be more spoilers than before for these stories, so if you want to hear my overall thoughts, then head to the timestamp.
The Colour of Terror is an interesting story, with a lot going for it, but a few shortcomings as well. Written by Lizzie Hopley, The Colour of Terror sees the Doctor appearing in a charity shop as someone goes missing, and the colour red starts being infected by a new enemy. The story and adventure of this episode were well planned and thought out, doing well to establish the stakes and danger, and has no issue making all of the characters feel natural, bar one or two interactions, such as a scene where a character desperately wishes to tell the Doctor of his tragic backstory, and the Doctor doesn't really seem to care, only caring that he is willing to help, which is good in concept, but felt quite awkward and expository in the moment. There are a few other side characters like this that worked much better. The couple who are to be wed were both performed well, even if their story ends in a strange situation, but they do give you a warm feeling overall. As a secondary antagonist, there is Mrs. Bevel, played by Susan Penhaligon, who is a character who is well written and well performed, but written as a despicable character so well that she started to grate on me by the end. But I think that is more of a personal gripe than an indication of quality. There is another character that assists the Doctor, named Pete, played by Frank Skinner, who we last saw in Who on the television playing Perkins in The Mummy on the Orient Express. And he was quite entertaining as an insistent helper to the Doctor, being a main point of exposition on other characters while making it feel natural rather than obligatory. The Doctor himself is as good as ever, but what really stands out here is the villain, the Vermeen. Quite an interesting concept that is much like the Vashta Narada, a comparison used to great effect later. A sentient swarm that resides in the colour spectrum, specifically red. A daunting concept, and while its interactions get a little silly, such as possessing a cat or a crazed Mrs. Bevel covering herself in red paint, they are genuinely intimidating. And as they set their sights on the TARDIS, the stakes are felt quite strongly. Taking those thoughts into consideration, the story as a whole is pretty good and perfectly fits in as both a part of what may be Eccleston's final box set, but also a part of the series' finale box set, and feels like it would fit under Russell T Davies' regime of centering many of the stories in his era on Earth and around human modern-day characters. I'll give The Colour of Terror by Lizzie Hopley a 7 out of 10. Not the best, but certainly has a lot going for it, and, at least for me, had some pretty memorable scenes. Next is The Blooming Menace by James Kettle. This story was far simpler and by the numbers than the last. While not bad by any means, I found myself finding a few common tropes that not a lot is done with, and predictable twists that felt nothing more than par for the course. The villains and their plot twist of a controller are interesting as they insert themselves into men's lives and feed off the interactions, reminding me a lot of crinoids, and while they have enough to make them distinct, they don't stand out as far as other original villains from this run, such as the Vermeen or Trinity. Much like them, the new characters for the story aren't bad, but are still a far cry from how fluid and connected most of the cast in the last story felt. The Doctor is charming here, but there is also Toby Entwistle, played by Dave Hearn, who was entertaining, and his romance with the walking woman dresses as a man to accomplish something society holds women back from trope. Phil, played by Milanka Brooks, was a good character as well. Her keeping her charade up was certainly humorous, and something new is done with that idea, whereas usually there would be a big scene where she declares her real gender and they get together, the dangerous situation takes precedence, so they realise their feelings for each other while the gender thing is still being worked out, making the relationship stand out, and quite entertaining. The villain, Nanny Lewis, played by Rachel Stanley, who acts as the maid for the gentleman's club that the main characters are part of, pops up as the twist villain. And while the actress attempts to make the character unique, I was only entertained by her when she was in her daft pretend identity. And the scientist who is researching the plant creatures, that honestly I couldn't remember the name of and had to be reminded they are called Eulalia, is a fine enough character, but if not for the delivery of the actor, would be completely unremarkable. So this episode leaves a lot to be desired. I wouldn't call it bad by any meaning of the word, but it certainly could have been better. So I'll give The Blooming Menace by James Kettle an average 5 out of 10. Finally in this box set is The Ninth Doctor Adventures Season 2 Episode 12, Red Darkness. An interesting story with great ideas, but did it land in its execution? This episode holds two returning villains, one in not a very traditional sense, the Vash and Arada. This being what I think may be their third appearance in the audio dramas. And the villain from just two episodes ago, the Vermeen, involved in a strange cooperation of sorts, mixing to become the Red Darkness. A very creative idea, and is used to good measure in this story, leading to a heightened feeling of stakes, and much like the Vash and Arada themselves, the mix of abilities the Red Darkness has is quite bone-chilling. Of course, not to the same effect it is in the original visual medium, but is still well done. The Doctor is good in this story, being put in many different situations and having to take different actions to normal that really show off differing sides of the character than usual, such as having to act as if under the Red Darkness's influence, although it's not that difficult, but also in how he interacts with a new character, with a very fun dog, being Adam Martin, playing Callan Lennox, son of a scientist who resides and has been stuck on the planet the Red Darkness calls home. He is a very interesting character, and while the whole teenager storming off from his parent that doesn't understand trope can get a bit annoying, his relationship with both the scientists and his dog are used to great emotional effect. There is also another aspect of the story that I felt could have been expanded on more, as I feel it only serves as a Chekhov's gun, more than that of a key throughout the entire story, that being the warnings of the Red Darkness, coming across as a sort of old folktale or myth on the planet, giving the Doctor hints. This does slightly add to the atmosphere, though, something I felt the story excels at through vocalization and sound design. As a whole, I think this is a really good story, even if there are some shortcomings with the characters' writing and construction of the story. But its use of these characters in the story's progression, and how it uses its villains, does well to get you invested in the atmosphere. And I think that this story is a good place to not only leave open for more stories to come, but also as a high note, if they had actually decided for the Ninth Doctor's adventures to end here. And I can only hope that when that unfortunate eventuality comes to pass, that this is the type of story that his run could end on. I give Red Darkness, written by Roy Gill, an 8.5 out of 10, giving this box set as a whole, Shades of Fear, a total of 6.8 out of 10, put on this lovely graph that I made to display the overall rankings of every Ninth Doctor box set we've reviewed so far. But to be honest, with how strong of a start they seem to have had, I may need to reevaluate my opinions on the first two box sets. Thank you everybody for watching my video where I reviewed the last two Ninth Doctor box sets that have come out. It's been a while since I've made a video as I've been quite busy, but hopefully I'll be able to make some more videos without multiple months being in between them. Please like the video if you liked it, comment down below if you wish, write about anything you'd like me to review next, subscribe to the channel if you want to see more, and if you do, ring the notification bell so you're told that every single time I make an upload. Once again, thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye! Toast! A little piece of toast. Because there's so much to choose from. There's brown bread, white bread, all sorts of wholemeal bread. It comes in family packages with writing on the side.